Hey folks, Marco here. Those watching me for the first time probably didn't expect to face my incredibly thick European accent. Since I'll be flaunting it throughout the video, do make use of subtitles if you need them. Did you know that I spend an entire day sometimes editing my transcript, changing ComfyUI into ComfyUI? Subtitles correctly spell the technical terms, like the names of settings or nodes, which also improves YouTube's auto-translate feature for those who watch me in another language. So in short, subs are there if you need them, folks. That is all. Prereqs for the video are the same as before, and with that said, let's jump in. Although most of you click to watch this video in order to learn about upscaling in ComfyUI, I suspect that a significant part of the audience already knows the basics and watches to get further insights or perspectives, or just perhaps my terrible jokes. If that is you, then you probably want me to hurry the hell up. So what do I do? Which audience do I cater to? Should I make you watch me as I build a workflow from scratch, or do I drag and drop workflow and talk about it? Well, I was in creative mode this week, so I decided to try and be innovative. Essentially, you are looking at an IKEA-style, ready-to-assemble DIY workflow. Now, before we start assembling this, a word of caution. Whenever you drag and drop someone's workflow, always check your inputs. Searching for and checking input nodes should literally be the very first thing you do. My workflow only has two input nodes, load checkpoint and load image. And on purpose, I did not put input mask into my inputs folder. And it is obvious that it's missing, because if the image was there, then we would have something showing here already. However, when you use someone else's workflows, it doesn't have to be obvious. It can be quite subtle. Let me just show you what I mean. Let's say I want to try Flux for the first time, and I've never used Flux before. So I decide, okay, well, this is a developer's website. This is the image he generated. And let's say I want to learn how to use Flux. This isn't part of the video, but just to illustrate the point. The very first thing I do is check the inputs. Check the input nodes. Do I have Flux1 dev? If I click on this file name, you can see this thing pops up. So that way I know that I have the right file and it is in the correct location. But then if I click on this file, nothing happens. This is how I know that I don't have this file. So just because you have file name written, do not assume that this file is already on your computer, or even if it is, that it is in the correct folder. In fact, if I press either one of the two arrows, you can see that it suddenly switches it to undefined, and now I can't change it back to what it was. So the first thing you do when you bring in someone's workflow, you check your inputs. All right, with that said, let's go back now. So I have off screen placed the input where it is, and now if I click on it, if it doesn't show up, that's because I still need to click this refresh button. But once I do, and nodes get refreshed, then I get to select it. All right, so I'm going to begin by clicking on Reset View. Then when I zoom out, you can see that I have actually on purpose placed all my groups on the right-hand side, because that allows me to just drag the ones I want to the left and align them. So let's just grab the nodes with numbers. Should be just 1 to 4. All right, and now connecting this should be pretty straightforward. As I said before, this should be a preview bridge node, but for purposes of reproducibility, I have left it as a load image. So normally this image would have flown here and I would have applied the mask, and then mask and image would have continued on from here, but we're doing it this way. And now it's all connected. As I said before, I don't add any output nodes to my workflows. That is your job, because output nodes control how far this workflow goes. It's much easier to troubleshoot a workflow if you do it one bit at a time. So first, let's try and see if we can get the workflow to run up till this point. Then we can try up till here, preview the masking, and then see the output here. This image is not the best example, but think of it as the first year computer lab where you're learning about the circuit theory. You can think of output nodes as your instruments that you use to measure current, voltage, and other parameters at different points in your circuit. We don't need to run the whole workflow all at once, so let's just start with here, with this bit. I'm just going to run and see what happens. And here we go. I got the image here. So my prompt was basically just cinematic landscape of tropical island, rocky terrain, that sort of stuff, and that's precisely what I got. So then, at this point here, what I do is I replace the prompt with something else. I'm prompting for a pirate standing on the beach. And here I apply a mask. So now I'm going to preview that mask using a preview node, but this is a sex preview. So I'm just going to place this here and use this here as a fallback image. And now when I preview it, you can see that's what my mask looks like. My crop factor is set at 2.2. So here you can check different values and what effect it has. We've covered this in previous video. Since I'm happy with this, I'm just going to delete preview node. And lastly, I'll drag this here, connect to the output, and let's see the output. And there is our horny pirate. Upscaling basically means increasing the resolution of the image. As you know, in automatic 1111, this is done through extras tab. You can set the factor by how much you want to upscale the image. And as you can see, there are many different upscaling options to choose from. One thing they all have in common though, their fundamental flaw, if you will, is that the process inherently creates new data. You are effectively generating pixels that didn't originally exist in the image, or you are inventing new information. Just to use this one as an example, in ComfyUI, traditional upscaling algorithms are accessed through image upscale by node. So that's this one here. So to use those same settings, I will set this value to 2. Now we can run the workflow. So this algorithm is the fastest and possibly the worst because it simply duplicates the pixels. Bilinear works by finding the average, and bicubic works by fitting third degree polynomials to help you visualize. With linear, you're finding the average. The value in the middle is the average between the two. With cubic, you have 4 pixels, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then the values would be the values that are along the curve. Bilinear and bicubic are basically the same thing except in two dimensions, and that leaves us with this last one called, this one's actually pronounced Lanczos resampling, after Hungarian physicist Kornél Lanczos. So anyway, these are traditional algorithmic methods of upscaling. These have existed way before we got generative AI. The other way to upscale, apart from these traditional methods, is by using AI. In ComfyUI, you do that by using a node called Image Upscale Using Model. So I'm just going to load let's say maybe this one here, because it upscales by a factor of 2, and then I will just duplicate this node and connect these. So now if I run this, well, we can check the comparison, and as you can see, this one is clearly the better of the two, at least to my eye. So AI is clearly better at guessing the pixels, but it also has its limits. If there is something unusual in the image, like a hairless cat, for example, AI might decide to give cat fur as you upscale, but for natural scenery like this, it works really well, as you can see. Now, if you're coming from automatic 1111, you know that when you choose these upscalers, for example, this one here, which upscales by a factor of 4, it still lets you choose what size you want. So how is this possible? Well, it's because there is a downscaler right after the upscaler. To downscale an image, you use exactly the same node you have used to upscale it. All you have to do is set this value to less than 1. And although area resampling isn't ideal, apparently it is a good downscaler technique. So I could use that, set this to 0.5, and then let's say I make this something that doesn't have something that doesn't upscale at times 2, for example, let's say ultra sharp. So we can call this. So now if I copy and paste and then run this one, see what this one looks like. Lastly, there is a method of generating high resolution images without upscaling them. Let me just quickly tidy this up. The trick is, so instead of upscaling the image, what you do instead is you upscale its latent. So analogous to upscale image by node. So we will use upscale latent by, or latent upscale by. You can see much of the same algorithms listed here as well, but this is all happening in latent space, so it's a little bit hard for us to visualize. And what happens in the end, I'm just going to reroute the output here to run this. And you can see for yourself, for users of automatic 1111, this answers at least 2 questions. Firstly, why is latent upscale not available in extras tab, but it is available under high res fix? Because if you upscale without sampling, this would be the output. And secondly, how many times did you have to change denoising strength from 0.7 to 0.4? So why is the default setting for denoising strength so high? Because given the default setting for the upscaler, your upscaled latent requires a lot of denoising because what you're sending looks like this. Now, don't be too quick to dismiss latent upscaling. It definitely has a place in the workflow, just probably not at the end. Given its high denoising strength, you would want to do this before any sort of inpainting and detailing. It's a good thing to use with a prompt containing terms you don't mind appearing throughout the image. For example, I don't mind lightning strikes across, I don't mind rocks across, waves, clouds, but I do mind if I had lots of pirates all over the image, because that's not what I initially wanted. So let me quickly do an upscaling for you. So I'm just going to copy this node because I'm lazy, and I'm going to copy the K-sampler as well, and we will set the value here to 0.7. This kind of upscaling also works better when the upscale factor is a smaller number. So I'll choose 1.25 and let's duplicate this. I'll set this to 1.6. Why? Because when you multiply 1.25 and 1.6, it gives you a 2. So essentially, this doubles the resolution. Now let's connect these and see how this works. Not too bad. In fact, the last two groups are basically for you to play around this. Delete all this. So if you want to preview all of these, let's see, what was I doing here? Connect this here. So here's the first pass. You can see it before and after sampling. And here's the next one. Again, you see it before and after sampling. And with this third video, we have now covered fundamentals of ComfyUI. I am unsure whether to continue the series. I will experiment with the workflow and see if I can make something out of it. Perhaps control nets, IP adapter, or LoRAs could be the next topic to cover. Leave a comment if you have any suggestions. Otherwise, please share, like, and subscribe. Also, if you got value from this video and can afford it, please consider buying me a coffee or supporting me on Patreon. Although nothing is currently behind the paywall, you are investing into the future of this channel. Alrighty then, thanks for watching and class dismissed.